I think there are some still trickling on in. I'll take my time getting down here, I guess. Okay, so who is excited to be here today? I'm super excited to see Daryl back after a long time and just glad that God's healing him up. So we've got some announcements. Tonight is our Trunk or Treat Family Fest. It's going to rain, so we're going to be inside. And so we've got some good plans for that. We're still going to have goats inside in the gym. They'll have diapers. It'll be adorable. So that's that for that. So if you're scheduled to do a trunk, still come on down. If you're scheduled to do anything else, still plan on coming if you can. If you're not scheduled, but you'd like to come and have a hot dog or just hang out or listen to praise music in the back, we encourage you to do that as well. It's going to be a great time and praying that God's honored in that. The Equip training event is next Saturday. The price has gone up from $15. I don't know what it is, but if you still want to go, still time to register for that. Holiday Vendor Fair is on November the 11th, and it supports Consumed Youth. Terre Haute Missionary Gathering is the very next day on the 12th at 5, and that'll be here. And the pastor from Union Chapel will be delivering the message that night. Senior Saints Thanksgiving Party has changed the date to the 9th of November, and there's a get-together CL for what to bring with that. And then Thanksgiving Baskets for the Needy, and this year Valerie and Liz are leading that again, and they'll be collecting money this year instead of the items so that they can do their thrifty shopping prowess. Okay, and that's all I have.
Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you this morning. Can I share with you a secret? It's not really a secret. God has been so good to me. So good to me. Anybody else? He's been good to you too? He's been so good to me. And so it's good for us to come together and to worship the Lord this morning. And I'm so glad that I get to do it with you all. So this morning, as we begin our time of worshiping the Lord, let's worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. Let's give back to Him just a portion of what He's given to us. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning, and let's thank Him for what He's done for us. Lord, sometimes I feel like thank you isn't even enough for all that you've done. When everything else in life seems to move as the wind blows, Lord, you never do. You're a firm place for us to plant our feet. And Lord, you never waver in being good to your people. Regardless of what we do, none of that matters. Your goodness remains the same. And so, Lord, we come this morning thanking you for all that you've done for us. Lord, we want to worship you in this place today. We come to praise your name and to lift your name high as it deserves to be lifted. And so, Lord, this morning, as we worship you, Lord, we want to bring back just a portion of what you've given to us. And so, Lord, we pray that you will take those offerings and those tithes this morning, Lord, and that you will use them, help us to use them in a way that furthers your kingdom here on earth. Because, Lord, time is running short. Remind us of that today, Lord. There's still work to be done. The harvest is still ready. And so, Lord, give us opportunities to continue to go to those people and tell them all about your goodness. And so, Lord, help us this morning. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Those plates are still here in the front, or we can do online as well. Let's take a couple moments here. Let's greet one another. Tell somebody you're happy to see him here this morning.
I'm on. Good morning. Does everybody stand with me this morning? Stand up. Get awake. So glad you're here with us today, worshiping this morning and online. We are just so grateful to see all those bright, smiling faces this morning. Are you ready to worship today? Okay. Matthew 7, 24 through 27 says, "So then everyone who hears my words and puts them into practice is like a wise man. He builds his house on the rock. The rain comes down, the water rises, and the winds blow and beat against the house, but it does not fall. It is built on the rock. But everyone who hears my words and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man. He builds his house on the sand. The rain comes, the water rises, and the winds blow and beat against that house, and it falls with a loud crash." We all have some foundation, a foundation. It depends on you what that is. If you follow the Lord, you're on solid rock. If you follow like the foolish man, whew, there you go. So we're going to worship today because we know that God is the strong foundation, and we are going to worship him today because he is so worthy of our praise this morning. Sing loud. Sing unto the Lord today.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Thank you. who brings our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
My reward and all the my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will see no turning back. I've been set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. Christ, my all in all. Joy of my salvation. And this hope will never fail. Heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing. Jesus is here. To God be the glory. Is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad than I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I built my faith in Jesus. 'Cause Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. Oh, rain came and went. Gloom in my house was built on you. And I'm safe. On you, Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. And great are you. Great are you, Lord.
to our time of prayer here in just a few moments. But in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verse 25, there was a woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years, and she suffered many things. She spent all she had on physicians, but grew worse and worse. You know, they called her the woman with the issues. And you know, all of us face issues in life that are normal, a normal cycle of life. But sometimes those normal cycles in life become abnormal. And we get stuck. We get stuck in depression. We get stuck in fear. We get stuck in our finances. We're stuck and we need help. When she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If I only can touch his clothes, I shall be made well." She was 100% convinced in her mind that Jesus can not only do something, but he will do something. He will do something if I take a risk and step out in faith. She was isolated. She was lonely. She was basically a leper because of her condition. But that didn't stop her from wanting to get to Jesus. Immediately, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of the affliction. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that power had gone out of him, turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And what's interesting about the word power, it's the same word as dynamite. Jesus is the dynamite, and her touch was the accelerant. And when she touched Jesus, she was, this girl is on fire. She was on fire. But his disciples said to him, "You see the multitudes who thronged you, and you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see her and who had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your afflictions." She wanted to just slither on back into the shadows, but Jesus said, "No, I want the world to know that you are made whole. You are made clean. You are accepted by me. I want you to have peace. I want you to have peace. God wants you to have peace." And so this morning, if you are stuck, if you are stuck in a cycle, run to Jesus this morning. Believe that he not only can, but he will. He will touch you. If you need a touch from Jesus this morning in any way, no matter what it is, I just invite you to pray with me for the next few moments. Oh Lord, you are so gracious to us that you would leave heaven to come to fix what is broken, to begin to reverse the curse, because you love us. That's who you are. You are compassionate. You are caring. You are loving. You are just. You are merciful. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And Lord, we confess that we can get stuck because of life, because we live in this fallen world. We can go through seasons of depression, seasons of isolation, seasons of loneliness, seasons of questioning why this happened. And we fear the future, and we will do everything that we can to fix it. And then we realize we can't fix it, that you're the only one who can. And we hear you're around. We hear that you're near. And we come to the end of ourselves and we run to you with everything that we have. No matter what people think of us, no matter the ridicule we may face, we run to you. We are in a desperate situation that only you can fix. And And Lord, we will not only need your touch for salvation, but we will need your touch many times through this journey of life, because we will face situations that will just bring us to our knees. And so, Lord, we depend on you every hour of every day to touch us, Lord. We need you. We are desperate for you this morning. So, Lord, I pray today that you will fall afresh on us, not only as individuals, but as a local church, that we will be set free, that we will be healed, that we will be whole, and that we will know that we are accepted by you because we believe, and that we will be a people on fire, a people on fire for you, because all we want to do is to get to you. So Lord, today I pray today that you will touch us, each one of us, Lord, touch our local church. We want to be a church that is on fire for you. We do, Lord. So Holy Spirit, just move through this sanctuary today. Fill us afresh. Rearrange whatever needs to be rearranged in our life, whatever priorities needs to be rearranged. Do a new work in us today, Lord. Give us peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, I pray as we move on through the rest of the service, Lord, that you'll anoint Pastor Denny's tongue, that mountains will be moved as we hear your word preached, and that most of all, Lord, you will be glorified, that we will leave here rejoicing and praising you because you are on the throne. You have won the victory. You are with us. So we thank you for it, Lord. We thank you for loving us. May you be pleased with our worship today. And as we leave here today, may each one of us be able to say, I have met with the Lord Jesus Christ in some way. To you, Lord, be all the honor and glory that you are due. It's in your mighty and wonderful and precious name we pray all these things. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Yeah.
Sorry to take some of your time, Denny, but it wouldn't be right for me not to come up here. 2.5 months ago, the Lord saved me as I was laying on the interstate. I don't know why, but I know he's got something else planned for me. So I just have to thank the Lord. I thank every one of you. When we came back and we had cards and meals and people that watched over us. I'd like to thank Denny for coming out, because there's been some days it's been hard. I'm not one to just sit, and this has probably been the hardest thing. But to see all of you again today, because I'll be honest, laying there holding onto that truck, I really didn't think I would. And there were times I prayed to the Lord while I was there, please just let me pass out, because I couldn't take it anymore. And there were actually times I thought, I sat there and I sang to myself, holding onto that tire. And I laid there for an hour and nobody stopped. And nobody's going to convince me, but after an hour, a truck driver stopped. And I never got his name, and the policeman didn't get his name. But he came up behind me because I was trapped under the truck and he didn't want to move it. But he put his arms around me and just knelt behind me and held on to me. And nobody's going to convince me that that wasn't the Lord, because yeah, I know it was.
Right. That's right. Yeah.
And I, you know, I laid there and I thought of my family. You know, I thought, I'm never going to see my... wife and my daughters again, and my grandchildren. And the Lord heard that.
Yes, he did.
He touched me and he helped me there.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Praise his name.
But I just pray now that the Lord will let me know what I'm here for. Because I don't know. I'm going to have a long time to think about it now for a while. But I just wanted to thank all of you for all your prayers and everything that everyone did. We really appreciate it. And lastly, I want to thank the Lord for my wife. You don't know what love is till you can't make it to the bathroom and you have to have somebody help you get cleaned up. And you can't walk to get, but she's been there the whole time and she's taking care of me. And I know it's not been easy. And I'm not the best patient in the world. I've tried, but I'm not. And the Lord has really blessed me. And I want to thank you all. Thank you.
Absolutely. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Hey, let's come down around here. This is a part of what God is using him right now to be a part of. Calling us to that place of realizing that without God, we have nothing. That he will always provide. Well, let's reach out, touch the one in front of you, put a hand on the shoulder. Let's believe. Lord, thank you so much for the reminders that you are affording us today through your son, Daryl. Thank you, God, for what you have said through him. We know, God, that what is going on right now is exactly, Lord, what you are doing, what you are orchestrating in and through his life. We don't understand, never will in this life, Lord, why things do happen the way they do at times. Why there is pain and why there's suffering and why there's chaos, why there's confusion, Lord. Why there are moments that seem to be hopeless and full of despair, God. But thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that there is never a second that goes by, even a millisecond that goes by, that you are not present. You are always there, Lord. You promise to never leave and never forsake, and that's exactly what you do at all times. Even, Lord, when it seems as though you are so far away that we have no idea if you're even real now. No, Lord, you are right there, right there, right there. And you always, Lord, come to the place by showing us through things, Lord, that we would never, ever dreamt would be possible, that you would ever use even a truck driver, Lord. And we know that that was you, God. Whether that is a person that is still walking on this earth or that was one of your angels that you sent to comfort your son. Lord, we thank you for you and your provisions for all things. And we know, Lord, that's not going to stop now. You're going to keep pouring upon Daryl and Liz and their family. And Lord, you're going to use them in ways that they never thought possible with the experiences, Lord, that you have journeyed them through and will continue to lead them through. And Lord, you are going to show us as the family of God what it really means to have faith. Faith, Lord, when it doesn't seem as though we've got any to give, to any to even acknowledge, Lord, that you always provide a way. So thank you, Lord, right now. And we pray as we've been praying, we pray together right now with all faith gathered around our brother, gathered around our friend, gathered around again your son. We pray that you would touch him and his wife and his family, Lord, especially this body, Lord, that you know inside and out. Everything about it, Lord, that you would touch him right where he needs touch, that you would bring healing where there is need of healing, restoration, Lord, where doctors and nurses and procedures could never, ever do anything about. You, God, can do exceedingly, abundantly, beyond what any of us could ever think, ask, or even imagine. Thank you, God. We believe in the power of God through faith that you will touch him in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And everyone said amen. Amen. Oh, give the Lord a praise. Can you do that? Amen. 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 Oh my. Can you stand back up with me just for a moment here? I appreciate it. It's the final Sunday of October, of course. If you've paid any attention at all, the calendar, if you haven't, it's the final Sunday of October. So if you've wondered about October, it's just gone right by, moved quickly. But when it comes to this final Sunday of October, it's also the final Sunday of this series that we've been into. Faith that can move. Faith that moves mountains. Something kind of began to strike me, and this is not at all a coincidence that Daryl's here today and testimony in our prayer time that sometimes we must climb the mountain. Read this with me. Matthew 17:20, it's famous because of that mustard seed. But let's read it together. You don't have enough faith, Jesus told them. I tell you the truth, if you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. Lord, Lord, we need You more than our minds can comprehend. We need to have a greater understanding of what faith really is. And it must be something so significantly powerful that even faith that is as small as a mustard seed, even that much of faith in God can do something extraordinary. Something that we can never ever do on our own. So Lord, give us please greater understanding today. But Lord, we know that if we're going to have greater understanding, we have to have a greater openness to You to receive it. So Lord, help us right now to have hearts that are more open than they have been. Lord, give us minds that are more open to You than they have been. Help us to have ears, Lord, that are more open to hear what You are saying to us than they have been. And God, help us to have Your eyes so that we can see things that we cannot see. And give us strength, Lord. Strength that is strength of the Lord, so that we can do what we must do for You. In Your precious name, amen. You may be seated there. As much as you and I would like to see that mountains that are in our way, along in our pathway, something that is significant, that seems to be a struggle, seems to be an object that stands in our way of our moving forward, as much as you and I would like for those mountains, those obstacles to be moved out of our way, at times the mountain, the obstacle, must be climbed. It won't be removed from our path. Our path won't be guided around it. At times, we must climb what's in front of us. Genesis 22 gives us understanding of this. Let me just share a few things. If you're taking notes, number one is it's time to climb the mountain. You know, it's one thing to stand at the mountain and look at the mountain and pray in front of the mountain and pray to God for the mountain to be moved. But sometimes we get to the place it's time to climb it. The first thing that we've got to understand is to know where we are to go, what we are to do. That wherever we might find ourselves, as difficulty might seem to be prevailing, struggle might just seem to be pressing on us, and it's like, how can we get beyond this? We find it within God giving us a fresh understanding, a fresh revelation of what we must do and where we must go. And it can be disturbing. It can be troubling. We've got to know that when Abraham received a revelation from God of what he must do, and that his one and only son Isaac was involved in this, it had to be overwhelmingly difficult. This backstory, you know, Abraham and Sarah, they were not able to have children. God said, you're going to have a child. You're going to have a son. You're going to name him Isaac. Neither one of them believed it, but definitely Sarah. She's like, I can't have kids. Are you serious? That can't happen. And the story just unfolds. She ends up having the baby. And you got to know when you have the baby, this baby that you could not have, it's miracle. It's miracle right there. You sing it. It's miracle that you're holding. And now God's saying to do something that involves this miracle that you have received. And what he's telling you to do with that is going to require a faith that maybe, just maybe, really quite possibly, you don't have to fulfill it. But if God says to go, I don't know, I can't answer for you. All I can do is answer for me. If God tells me to go, Wilson better go. But let me tell you this, though. If that's the case for me, and not that it's got to be the same thing for you, too. But when it comes to Scripture, if God says to do something to you, you better do it. If God is telling us to do something, to go somewhere, we better do it. We better go. We better act on it. Because he is not revealing something that's wrong, a wrong revelation. What God reveals is always perfectly accurate, perfectly correct. So it says in verse 1 of Genesis 22, sometime later, God tested Abraham's faith. Abraham, God called. Yes, he replied, here I am. Take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains, which I will show you. The next morning, Abraham got up early. Abraham was at all human, which he was. There's no way at all that I can be convinced that when he received the revelation, that Abraham didn't swallow hard. Yes, he had faith. Yes, he is the father of our faith. But if he is a human being at all, he is swallowing hard, being asked of God to do something with what is so, so extra special to him.
But because of his relationship with God being the most important one that he has above everyone else, even Sarah and his boy, he gets up early the next morning to go. When you realize that it's time to do something that you don't have what it takes to do, you've got to lean more into the one that's able to provide what's needed for what's being asked of you. You cannot pull yourself up by your bootstraps. It takes much more than that. You can't assemble all the things that you think are required to accomplish the task that has been put before you. You can't muster up enough to do it. You've got to have the one that has called you to do this in faith. You've got to lean on him. And even more than just leaning on, you have got to allow him to have control of you so that you are guided exactly to the spot to do the exact task that has been asked. See, God gave you and me life. He birthed us into this world for himself. I've said that before several times. It's a reminder. God gave you and me life for himself. One part of the beauty of that one, that the precious life that has been given, is that he allows us to be connected one with the other, that we can be a part of family, that we can be a part of a journey together. But the most important part of our receiving life is him. For him. So if God is giving us a revelation to go somewhere, to do something, it's not always going to be easy. To be honest, rarely is it easy. And you understand why, don't you? Because if it was always easy, why would you need faith? If everything was a cakewalk with the cake that you love most, say, I don't like cake. What if it was a pie walk and it was the pie you love most? I don't love pie. Whatever you like the most, it's that walk. But with God, it's rarely going to be that. Because we have to know that we have a faith in him to do what he has called us to do, so that our faith in him is able to accomplish more than we ever dreamt possible. So in latter part of verse 3 in Genesis 22, he, Abraham, saddled his donkey and took two of his servants with him, along with his son Isaac. Then he chopped wood for a fire, for a burnt offering, and set it out for the place of God, and told that God had told him about. Verse 4, on the third day of that journey, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. Stay here with the donkey, Abraham told the servants. The boy and I will travel a little farther. We will worship there, and then we will come right back. It's time to climb the mountain. I'm not telling anybody, to stop praying about the movement of the mountain. We must continue to believe that if God wants to move that mountain, that we will have the faith that we should in God, even if it is as small as a mustard seed. That's how much is required to move that mountain. If that mountain is to move, we're going to have that faith that it will. But if God says go, and he's moving us in the direction to climb, it's time to climb. Because it's very possible that if we are to climb, that's when the mountain begins to move and begins to change. So they did just that. Abraham took Isaac and they began to journey up the mountain. Again, all this time, Abraham knows what he is to do. So he is climbing the mountain in faith, trusting in God, that God's going to lead him to do what God told him to do. Even though what God told him to do sounds absolutely ludicrous. But again, everything is for God. Everything is by God. So if we're going to climb the mountain, because we must, God, we're believing, point two, God will provide on the mountain. Sometimes a mountain that we think is something lofty, way beyond us, has snow-capped peaks. Sometimes it's a highway by a pickup truck with a tire resting on you, and you don't know what to do. What am I supposed to do? You heard it. As sincere and as authentic as you could from the one that was dealing with the mountain, the struggle, the chaos, the pain, the agony, the anxiety, the worry, the fear. Putting faith in God is the answer, the only answer. And what God always does, not just sometime, not just when it's opportune, no, all the time, God will always, 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 say the word with me, always provide. Most of the time, it's not going to be the provision that you think that he should have provided. It's true. But God will always provide. And he does. He's proven it time and time and time again. He keeps doing it. Well, most people will say, well, if he's still doing it, why won't he do it for me? He is, and maybe you just don't see it yet. Because he may just be providing in a way that you're not paying attention to. That's not condemning you. That's not belittling you. It's just saying that we need to have a faith that believes, even if it's a mustard seed size of faith, that God is showing up. He is doing exactly what he promised to do. He is showing us over and over and over again that he is Jehovah Jireh. Say that word with me. Jehovah Jireh. That means our Lord will provide. Won't you stand with me at that point, please? Listen, so Abraham placed the wood for the burnt offering on Isaac's shoulders while he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them walked on together, Isaac turned to Abraham, his father, and said, Father, yes, my son, we have the fire and we have the wood. Where is the sheep for the burnt offering. God will provide a sheep for the burnt offering, Abraham said. And they both walked on together. They climbed the mountain that was before them. Abraham did exactly what God asked him to do, to take his son, his one and only son, up to the top of a mountain that where he told him to go and place his son, his one and only son, as a sacrifice to God. It really does work hand in hand with what we learned together last week. We praise God because he deserves it. We lift him high because he deserves to be exalted. And it takes us to a place we begin to worship him. We offer him the worship because he deserves that too, so much so that we bow before him, which means there is surrender to him of everything. And when we surrender to him, as we're bowing before him, there is sacrifice that takes place. And from that sacrifice, like Abraham did with his son Isaac, fulfilling what God required of Abraham to do, God saw his faith in action. God wants to see your and my faith in action. If he's required the mustard seed size to do something, then let's muster up a mustard seed size faith and be active with that mustard seed of faith so that God sees that we have faith in him. And when Abraham showed him that, at least that much faith, by going through all the way to the point where he had the knife up in his hand to come down upon his son to strike him dead, and then a fire would consume the offering, God stopped him. You see, if we withhold from God what he asked of us, him being able to see our faith is pretty slim. He already knows how much we have anyway. But if we can muster up mustard seed of faith and offer him to go with him in faith to do what he asked of us, what he's requiring of us, he will do exactly what he's always done. He will provide. God stops Abraham's arm from coming down upon Isaac, and just over the way in a thicket is the provision of a ram. I don't think Abraham could have even thought it to turn out that way, but he knew God would provide some way. Don't ever allow anything or anyone in your life to become more important to you than God the Father. Don't allow yourself to put more faith in anything or anyone in this life than you do in the Lord Savior Jesus Christ. Mustard seed size of faith. God then has enough faith from you and me to respond. Could he respond without it? Well, sure, he's God. But he wants you and I to have faith in him. Don't miss out on any opportunity to see God provide for you with whatever situation you have. Don't allow yourself to miss the opportunity to see what God can do with the mountain that you face. Whether it's high and lofty peaks that looks like it's just nowhere possible. Can you reach the summit? Or it's on a highway where an hour of time would go by and no one stops to help you in the moment of your greatest need. But faith in God, God's providing. He sends somebody. What do you say? Maybe we begin to have mustard seed size faith at least that much, so that God can move mountains, so that we can see and witness and hear the provision of God happening. Amen. Bow your heads with me. Take a moment here and be as honest and as transparent as you possibly can be with the Lord. Again, he knows everything about you. So he knows what your mountains are. He knows what your struggles are, your difficulties, what's chaotic, what's painful, what's fearful. He knows all of those. But just take a moment right now and be just completely honest and transparent to him and say, Lord, here's what I've got. Here's my mountain. Here's my issue. Here's my struggle. Here's my battle. Here's my pain. Here's my source of bitterness. Here's my sin. It's yours, Lord. Am I me giving it to you, Lord? I'm trusting in you with faith that what needs to be done from here on, you will lead me, you will guide me, you will give me the strength that's needed, you will provide. God, please help us to have at least as much faith as you have required for a mountain to move, so that we can be witnesses and we can be encounterers of you, God, working you, God, doing and supplying and providing. Oh, God, help us to not miss out on what you want to provide by having a lack of faith. May we have faith that moves mountains. Even if at times we must climb them for our victory and to experience your provision. Thank you, God, for what will be done and what will be encountered as people decide to have faith in you that you deserve. We're praying all these things in the name of Jesus, we are. And before we conclude, Lord, would you do something extra special on this campus this afternoon and evening? Use us, God, for your glory and your honor in that endeavor, that as we gather together to shine your light and extend your love with our neighbors, with our community, let it, Lord, that during this festival tonight, there will be God moments. There will be awakenings that, God, you will show to those, and many of them don't believe you even exist today. That's how much of a field we have. People don't even believe you exist. May they realize when they come around here that you don't just exist, but you are alive and well. Use all for your glory. Lord, I pray for our leadership with Pastor Bree and everyone else. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And again, it's in your precious and holy name we pray. And everyone said amen. 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 Can we say praise the Lord? Yes. Well, God bless you. You go and you be faithful out there, even if it's the size of a mustard seed. Great things will happen. Love you all. God bless you.
Have a good one, brother.
Oh, God bless you, brother. Yeah. Yeah.